In today's video, we are going to be discussing synaptic plasticity. Your synapses do not remain constant strength throughout your entire life. If they did, you wouldn't be able to do things like learn or remember. This is a very complex topic, and we'll only be able to scratch the surface of it. It's also a very active area of research. After watching this video, you should be able to do the following. First, you should be able to describe the mechanism for long-term potentiation, or LTP, and long-term depression, LTD. Second, you should be able to describe how synaptic plasticity might be involved in drug addiction. There are many timescales over which synaptic plasticity can occur. Synaptic depression and synaptic facilitation occur over a very short time scale. If you take a synapse, so you have your sensory neuron and you can put a stimulating electrode in it, and you record from the postsynaptic neuron here, in some synapses you can see what's termed synaptic depression. So if you stimulate the presynaptic neuron twice within 200 milliseconds of each other and record the postsynaptic EPSP, you can see that the second EPSP has a much lower amplitude than the first one. So here, it's much lower than this EPSP. This is termed synaptic depression. It can be due to a number of factors, but one common reason would be that you do not have as much neurotransmitter ready to be released, so maybe all your active sites are not docked with vesicles. Alternatively, you could have synaptic facilitation. So if you stimulate your presynaptic cell twice within 20 milliseconds of each other, you can see that your first EPSP is about a millivolt in amplitude, and the second one is twice as large. Okay? So in addition to the temporal summation of both of them together, you have this facilitation where the second EPSP is larger than the first. This could be due to the fact that there's increased intracellular calcium concentration following the second depolarization. This could be because the calcium that entered the cell from the first depolarization is still around, and then it can sum with the additional calcium that enters following the second stimulation. One of the most well-studied forms of synaptic plasticity is long-term potentiation, or LTP. LTP was first discovered in hippocampal neurons and is thought to be involved in learning and memory. The form of LTP that occurs in the hippocampus relies on the NMDA receptor. The NMDA receptor is an ionotropic receptor that binds to glutamate. The NMDA receptor is unique, though, because it also has a second thing that needs to happen for it to open. You need to remove the block of magnesium over the pore. This can occur if the membrane potential of that cell becomes depolarized. That can then kick out that magnesium block. Under normal circumstances, if you have a stimulus coming from a presynaptic neuron, so it releases glutamate, glutamate can bind to the AMPA receptor, which is also an ionotropic receptor, allow in sodium, and depolarize your cell, as shown here. The membrane potential, though, does not become depolarized enough to remove that magnesium block. If instead you have a train of tetanic stimulation from your presynaptic neurons, you've got lots of glutamate in the cleft, your cell membrane potential is going to become depolarized enough to remove that magnesium block. So now sodium can flow through both the AMPA and NMDA receptors, and additionally you can get calcium influx through the NMDA receptor. This calcium influx can then cause a chain of signaling events inside the cell to cause synaptic plasticity. So if you wait a little while and then give another single stimulus from your presynaptic cell, you'll get an increased EPSP on the postsynaptic cell as compared to before your tetanic stimulation where you got that calcium entry. One of the reasons that occurs is that this calcium signaling cascade will increase the number of AMPA receptors on the cell membrane. Another way to look at this NMDA receptor-dependent LTP is shown in this figure. So you have glutamate release from your presynaptic neuron, which can open both the AMPA receptor channels and the NMDA receptor channels as long as that magnesium block is removed by membrane depolarization. Once the NMDA receptor is open, calcium can enter the cell, binds to CAM kinase 2, shown here, can start a signaling cascade that, among other things, can increase the trafficking of the AMPA receptor to the membrane. The signaling cascade can also lead to increased phosphorylation of either the AMPA or NMDA receptors, which will increase their likelihood or probability of opening. Each of these things will increase the amplitude of subsequent EPSPs. LTP can also be caused due to presynaptic mechanisms. For instance, calcium entry into the presynaptic cell can work through another signaling cascade to increase the amount of neurotransmitter released following every depolarization of the presynaptic cell. This will increase the amount of neurotransmitter in the cleft, which can then cause an increased postsynaptic EPSP. In some neurons, activation of the NMDA receptor can lead to long-term depression, or LTD. Usually this happens if there is moderate activation of the NMDA receptor, allowing some calcium in, which can bind to calcineurin and go through a signaling cascade to cause the internalization of AMPA receptors. This means there will be fewer AMPA receptors to be opened by the glutamate being released from the presynaptic neuron, and so your resulting postsynaptic EPSP will be smaller. Just as there are many ways to induce LTP, there are multiple ways to induce LTD. One that involves a presynaptic component is dependent on the release of endocannabinoids from the postsynaptic neuron. It's thought that calcium entry through voltage-gated calcium channels or a pathway set up by the mGluR1 or 5 receptor can lead to the start of a PLC-dependent signaling cascade, which can then cause the release of endocannabinoids. These can then bind to cannabinoid receptors on the presynaptic neuron and then act to reduce the amount of neurotransmitter that's released following each stimulation of the presynaptic neuron. With less neurotransmitter in the cleft, there'll be a smaller EPSP on the postsynaptic membrane. Homeostatic plasticity is thought to be very important in developing circuits. You can observe it in cultured neurons, so if you have a control petri dish filled with some neurons that are connected to each other, and record the control activity in that dish, you can see a firing rate as shown here. If you then block firing of those neurons by administering TTX or CNQX to the bath and wait and wash it out, you see a rebound increase in activity in your culture. So the firing rate post-TTX is much higher than it was in control conditions. If instead you increase the activity in the culture by adding bicuculin, once you wash that bicuculin out, you can see a much reduced firing rate in the cell culture. Synaptic plasticity is involved in learning, memory, and other normal functions of your brain, but it is also involved in addiction to drugs of abuse. The main area of the brain that seems to be essential for the development of addiction is the dopamine reward pathway. This includes the ventral tegmental area, shown here, which sends dopaminergic projections to both the nucleus accumbens, shown here, as well as the prefrontal cortex. It has been shown that after administration of most drugs of abuse, you will get dopamine release from the ventral tegmental area. You also get dopamine release from the VTA after you do things that are naturally rewarding, for instance, eating sugary foods or having sex. If we look at what's thought to be the mechanism of action for one drug of abuse, methamphetamine, we can see that it greatly increases the amount of dopamine in the synaptic cleft in the dopamine reward pathway. So methamphetamine can be taken up into the presynaptic neuron through the dopamine reuptake transporters. Once it's in the presynaptic neuron, it kicks out the dopamine molecules from the synaptic vesicles. When there's lots of dopamine in the presynaptic cell, the dopamine transporters start working in reverse and spit it out into the synaptic cleft. This increased amount of dopamine gets stuck in the cleft because the dopamine transporters are working in reverse, they're not reuptaking it back into the presynaptic neuron, and you get very high amounts of stimulation on the postsynaptic neuron because of this dopamine binding to the dopamine receptors. Long-term use of meth can cause to plasticity in your synapses. If you look at dopamine receptor levels in the dopamine reward pathway from a normal brain, shown here, the color codings indicate how many receptors there are, with red being the highest. You can see that there are many more dopamine receptors in the brain of a normal person as compared to meth user. So this is because overstimulation of the dopamine receptors on the postsynaptic neuron will cause them to be transported into the cell and the number of dopamine receptors on that cell to be lower than normal. This is an attempt to regulate the amount of stimulation going through the dopamine reward pathway, similar to what we saw with homeostatic plasticity. This also contributes to a common side effect of drug abuse, that of tolerance. So as you use meth for longer and longer, you need a higher and higher dose of meth to get your same high. Similarly, natural stimuli that are usually rewarding no longer seem to be, because they cannot release as much dopamine as your high dose of meth can. Not every person who uses a drug of abuse like meth becomes an addict. Therefore, addiction to drugs is a very complex process that is not well understood. In some animal models, if you block the NMDA receptor, specifically in the VTA, you can block the development of addiction in that animal model. This suggests that there might be some NMDA-mediated plasticity going on in the VTA that helps mediate this drug addiction. There is some evidence that many classes of drugs of abuse, including cocaine, can lead to NMDA receptor-dependent LTP. This includes trafficking of additional AMPA receptors to the membrane, which allow you to have a higher amplitude of EPSP on the postsynaptic cell. You can also get NMDA receptor-mediated activation of nitric oxide synthase, which will then release NO, which is thought to be able to decrease the amount of GABA released from inhibitory neurons onto that postsynaptic cell. In this way, by both decreasing inhibition and increasing excitation, you can get increased excitation of these VTA postsynaptic neurons. Many additional forms of synaptic plasticity have been observed in the dopamine reward pathway and other areas of the brain following drug addiction. This is a very complex topic that we can only scratch the surface of in this class. This is a very active area of research due to the public health implications. If we can understand how and why an addiction is formed and how we can reverse it, this will obviously have great impact on the lives of many individuals who are addicted to drugs. This concludes our video on synaptic plasticity. This was just a short introduction to a very complex topic. After watching this video, you should now be able to describe the mechanism for long-term potentiation, or LTP, as well as long-term depression, or LTD. You should also be able to describe how synaptic plasticity might be involved in drug addiction.